Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I'll be presenting today a topic of esophagus. I'll be discussing a few things about esophagus today. That will include embryology, histology, and anatomy, and some physiology of the esophagus. Starting from this diagram, which shows early digestive system and blood supply to an embryo, if you see at the middle, you see that this is the primordial gut with the blood supply in the back and the dorsal surface. And there is a small bud here, which I'll be referring to very soon. So, embryology of the esophagus. During the fourth week of the foregut development, a small diverticulum appears on the ventral surface of adjacent to the pharyngeal gut. That is the small diverticulum I showed in the previous slide. This is the tracheobronchial diverticulum. Subsequently, it elongates and gradually separates from the dorsal foregut through, by an esophageal tracheal septum. And that separates the esophagus from the trachea. The remaining part of the foregut rapidly elongates in the craniocaudal growth and of the embryonic body, forming the digestive system. That's the esophagus. So if you see in this diagram, this is the foregut, and it's getting separated from the respiratory tract by a tracheoesophageal septum. Okay, starting from this, this is from the front, and this is the respiratory tract forming the trachea and the bilateral bronchi, and this is the pharynx, and this is the esophagus. Okay, why did I mention that? Because any abnormality can lead to some congenital problem. This includes esophageal atresia. Esophageal atresia leads to polyhydramnios because that embryo cannot swallow that amniotic fluid. And we have the tracheoesophageal fistula, esophageal stenosis, and congenital hiatal hernia. Congenital hiatal hernia can happen in two different types. If the esophagus is too short, the whole stomach and the junction between the esophagus and the stomach will be pulled up, or it can be just sliding that the cardiac junction only will be pulled up. I didn't mention pictures of that because this presentation is about esophagus anatomy. Okay, these are some type of congenital tracheoesophageal fistula. If you see here, it's completely, the fistula with the upper part and the lower part is completely blunt. Coming down here, you see two fistulas are there between the upper and the lower part. And here they have one single fistula and there is a continuation of the full esophagus. And in this one, there is atresia of the upper part and the lower part is completely separated without fistula. And this one is aplasia of the trachea, and this is very little condition where there is no respiratory tract. Okay, histology of the esophagus. The esophagus also has four layers as any other GI tract, but it differs in the sense that it doesn't have serosa. So it has the fibrous, if we see the esophagus from outside inward, we'll find that fibrous coat, muscular coat, then submucosa and mucosa. The muscular coat has two different types of muscles. That's external longitudinal muscle and inner circular muscles. And the submucosa, it contains a lot of allular tissue and fatty tissue, which provides mobility to the esophagus. Then it also contains blood vessels, nerve, lymphatics, and mucous glands. The mucosa is folded into folds, in longitudinal folds, which makes it easy for the food to pass through and when it expands. Okay, so, and it consists of different type, three layers, which is muscularis mucosa, connective tissue, and then you have the epithelium, which is stratified squamous epithelium, and becomes junction columnar epithelium at the lower 1 to 2 centimeter, just near the cardiac orifice of the stomach. Now coming to the gross anatomy of the esophagus. Starting, what is esophagus? It is a flattened muscular tube around 18 to 26 centimeter from the upper sphincter to the lower esophageal sphincter. It connects the pharynx to the stomach. It commences at the lower border of the coracoid cartilage at level of C6. It descends in front of the spine through a posterior mediastinum, passes through the diaphragm and entering the abdomen. It terminates at the cardiac orifice of the stomach, opposite to the 11th thoracic vertebra. Okay, the direction of the esophagus. During the descendant of the esophagus, it turns to the left twice. That's at the root of the neck, starting from here. at the root of the neck, it goes turns to left once, then it goes back to the midline again. Sorry, from here to here is the root of the neck. Then it goes back to midline again. Then again, when once it pierces the diaphragm, it turns to left again. So it has two lateral curves, both going to left twice. Coming to sphincters of esophagus, it has two sphincters. That's upper sphincter and lower sphincter. The upper sphincter is at level of C6, formed by the inferior pharyngeal constrictor, merged with the coricopharyngeus muscle. That is the upper sphincter. Then the lower sphincter is only the circular muscles at level of T6, which has a high tone. Okay, coming to constrictions of the esophagus, which are important for while doing the endoscopies. In esophagus, you have around three constrictions. The first constriction is at 15 centimeters, then the second is 25 centimeters, and the third one is at 40 centimeters. The first constrictor is the same like the upper esophageal sphincter. Then the second one is formed by the when the aortic arch passes in front of the esophagus and the main left bronchus. And the last one is when the esophagus pierces the diaphragm. Seeing that the same thing from the side, this is a picture shows the constrictor from the side. If you see at this side where the esophagus starts, this is the upper sphincter, and this is the aorta passes in front of the esophagus, and this is the main left stem of the bronchus. This is the second sphincter, and this is here the third sphincter when the esophagus passes into the abdomen. Okay, how esophagus is divided? It's divided into three parts. One is cervical part, one is thoracic part, and the last one is abdominal part. So I'll discuss all the parts separately. I'll just give brief things about each part. So starting with the cervical esophagus, it extends from the pharyngeal esophageal junction at the lower border of the first thoracic vertebra, and it's around 5 to 6 centimeters. At this level, the esophagus, this is the relation which I'm going to mention, it's bordered anteriorly by the trachea and recurrent laryngeal nerves, and posteriorly by vertebral column, prevertebral muscle, and prevertebral layer of deep cervical fascia. And the lateral is the common carotid arteries and the posterior portion of the thyroid gland. Then coming to thoracic esophagus, it extends from the lower border of first thoracic vertebra to the diaphragmatic hiatus. It passes posterior to the trachea, the tracheal bifurcation, and the main left stem of the left stem bronchus, and it lies posterior and to the right of the aortic arch at the level of T4, and from level of T8 until the diaphragmatic hiatus, the esophagus lies anteriorly to the aorta. I'll come to some diagram very soon. Then abdominal esophagus, it's the shortest part, which is extends from the diaphragmatic hiatus to cardiac orifice of the stomach. It is a cone shape, about 1 centimeter long. The base of the esophagus transitions smoothly into the cardiac orifice. The abdominal esophagus lies on the posterior surface of the left lobe of the liver. That's known as the esophageal groove, which is directly related to left crest of the diaphragm and left inferior phrenic artery. Okay, the relation of the vagus nerve to the abdominal esophagus is like as follows. Left vagus nerve lies in the anterior wall of the esophagus, while the right lies posterior to the esophagus. That's due to embryonic rotation of the stomach. Okay, this picture shows that this is from front and this is from the back. This is the esophagus, and it's crossed by the aorta at this level. And this is the trachea and the left main bronchus. And if you see the same thing from the back, you see how the aorta crosses, starting from here, crosses the esophagus, and cause this is the first second constrictor I talked about. Then it passes backward, downward, going to posterior surface of the esophagus. So from the level of T8 downward, the aorta lies posterior to the esophagus. Okay, and if you see here, you have the right and left crura of diaphragm, where the both of them, they form the orifice of the esophageal orifice while entering the abdomen. So coming to blood supply, the blood supply of esophagus is very copious blood supply. So it is segmented blood supply. It's supplied by inferior thyroid artery, which supplies the upper esophagus sphincter and cervical esophagus. Then you have the esophageal arteries, and the branches of bronchial arteries supplies the thoracic esophagus and left gastric artery and branches of left phrenic or splenic artery supply the lower esophageal sphincter and distal segment of esophagus. And due to this copious blood supply, it's very rare to have esophageal infarction or leak while doing anastomosis in the esophagus. So this is diagram shows that blood supply of the esophagus. You have that carotids and the inferior thyroid artery from this side. And if you see these black lines are the bronchial, tracheobronchial arteries and esophageal arteries. And from this side, this is the, what you call it, celiac trunk giving splenic artery and left gastric artery. Just to remember, you can remember the other way. You have the cervical, thoracic, and abdominal esophagus. Each part of esophagus shares two organs, its blood supply. Like the cervical esophagus shares the thyroid gland and the trachea, and thoracic esophagus shares the trachea and bronchi, and abdominal esophagus shares the stomach and spleen. Okay, venous drainage, it's again segmental. It forms dense submucosal plexus of the plexus. The venous blood drains into the superior vena cava. The veins of the proximal and distal esophagus drain into the esophagus system. Collateral of the left gastric vein, branch of portal vein receives venous drain from the mid esophagus. The submucosal connection between the portal and systemic venous system in the distal esophagus form the esophageal varices, and which can be a cause of bleeding, GI bleed. So this diagram shows that venous drainage of the esophagus. We showed the superior vena cava and esophagus system. This is the hemiesophageal vein, and this is the portal system with the gastric veins. Nerve supply, it has a parasympathetic and sympathetic nerve supply. The parasympathetic nerve supply is from the vagus nerve and provide motor innervation of the esophagus and secretory motor innervation to the gland. So the motor and secretory motor are from the vagus. The systemic blood supply, you can remember it. Remember that the sympathetic blood supply is all going to the smooth muscles. So it's from T1 to T10. It regulates blood vessels, constrictions, esophageal sphincter contraction and relaxation, and muscular wall, and increases glandular and peristaltic activity. So if you see, all of them are related to smooth muscle, like blood vessels, esophagus constrictor, and the muscles of the esophagus. I don't know how clear it is, but this is the lymphatic drainage of the esophagus. So we have three parts. Can you see it, or it quite looks good?
Not very
okay.
Well.
Okay. Okay, I can divide into upper third, middle third, and lower third of esophagus. The upper third goes to supraclavicular lymph node, and middle third goes to superior mediastinal nodes and posterior mediastinal nodes, and the lower third goes to the celiac nodes. So all the three together, all the parts together, goes at the end to thoracic lymphatic duct, okay, and drain into right lymphatic duct. Okay, going to short physiology of esophagus. Obviously, everybody knows that esophagus transmits the foods from the mouth to and pharynx into the stomach. So it's primarily conducts food from pharynx and to the stomach, and its movements organized specifically in this of this function. Normally, it has two types of peristalsis. That's primary peristalsis and secondary peristalsis. The primary peristalsis constitute of peristaltic wave that begins at the pharynx and spread into the esophagus during pharyngeal stage of swelling. It passes all the way from the pharynx into the stomach. It is around 8 to 10 seconds. So you remember that the swelling has three phases, which is oral phase, pharyngeal phase, and pharyngeal phase and esophageal phase. So that started the pharyngeal stage. Then secondary peristalsis results from distension of the esophagus by retained food, and it continues until the food has emptied into the stomach. Okay, the upper esophageal sphincter, which I mentioned previously, is normally closed with excessive tone and does not allow any entry of air into the esophagus during inspiration. The mean resting pressure of the upper sphincter is around 40 millimeter mercury. During swelling, it relaxes for seconds and allows food to descend down. Then the tone increases up to 100 millimeter mercury, which pushes the bolus of the food downward into the esophagus. and the primary peristalsis start that time. Okay, what happens after that? The food, when it descends down within the thorax, intraluminal pressure is it's -5 to 5, -5 during inspiration and 5 during expiration. When the bolus passes down, the pressure reaches around 25 millimeter mercury with the peristalsis wave. What happens at the lower sphincter? Normally remains tonically constricted with pressure of around 30 millimeter mercury, in contrast to the mid portion of the esophagus, which is usually relaxed. When peristaltic wave passes downward, there is a receptive relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter ahead of the peristaltic wave, which allow easy propulsion of the food into the stomach. Lower pressure can cause acid reflux disease. I'm sorry. I just listed out some very common disorders of esophagus, but I'm not going to talk about them. I'm sure you will be having some idea about them. Maybe Zinker's diverticulum is worth mentioning, which is there is a part of the pharyngeal, it's pharyngeal diverticulum at the upper part of the esophagus. It's not supported by muscle posteriorly. So it's a false diverticulum where the mucus of the pharynx just goes form a diverticulum and just behind the esophagus. Okay.